start the next session that is going to be presented by Sudhakar, and he is going to give you an exposure to classification and clustering, which already you got it, but he will tell you more about it with example and with example in R. Over to you, Sudhakar.
Yeah, thank you very much, ma'am. Yeah, so as ma'am has mentioned that I will be discussing about classification and clustering, but I guess thankfully the theoretical part or the conceptual part, I should say, those things have already been covered by Ravindra Gudi sir. So maybe we will not harp on those points, rather we will focus mainly on the demonstration or something which is different, which I prepared different, those things I will be talking about. So coming to the slides, like the way I have organized is, you know, some examples or at least real life applications which all of us are using, maybe unknowingly, but all of us are definitely using some of the, you know, real life use cases of machine learning. So I will explain all these things in a bit in the upcoming slides, and then you will also see how to evaluate the model, you know, performance. Like we have built a model. Now, how do we check that model is doing good, doing bad, and what is the acceptable level of performance? Those things we will definitely have a look. And so coming to like basic machine learning, all of us know what is machine learning about, and these days it's, you know, wave kind of thing. It's a buzzword, and I must say it's a new technology which everyone is using right now, and be it any business, in fact, this machine learning or AI or DL, deep learning, is being used in some way or the other. So it's better, I think it's the time that we should start learning this technology, and thanks to the open source tools that we can learn it, you know, without investing any money. We can use it, the power of R, to, you know, learn machine learning. So the important point is that, you know, I think in the upcoming slide, I will show the relation between artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning. So I have here mentioned that AI, you know, AI is the big umbrella, and then machine learning is seen usually as a subset of artificial intelligence. Then further, I will also show where does deep learning fit in. So those things you will soon see, like artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, how do these things, you know, relate themselves in real life actually. So some of the applications, you know, I personally find the applications very interesting. Like in case of like the first point, commute estimation. So all of us have been using Ola, Uber, these kind of app every day. Maybe in lockdown we might not be using, but we have been using it sometime back before the pre-pandemic era. So in case of, suppose we are using Ola or Uber, anything. Now, if we get like, you know, estimated time to get the taxi is something like 15 minutes or something time, which is, you know, very high. So what will we do in that case? If we are in a hurry, or most of the time we are in a hurry to take the taxi to get to some place. But if the time is, you know, say 20 minutes, 25 minutes, then we won't take that ride. We will cancel that ride, in fact. So in those places, machine learning is actually running so that it is showing the optimized time and the optimized, like in that case, how to fix the price of the ride or how to minimize the waiting time. These things are very, very important. And machine learning algorithms are running behind that so that the companies, they don't lose out on customers. And at the same time, customers also get very, you know, very good experience with that particular taxi services like Ola, Uber, these two things we know. So riding apps, Google Maps for that matter, they optimize the traffic, I mean, not traffic, they optimize the path, in fact. Depending on the location of, you know, your smartphones, they can try to manage the path, or at least they can give you the best possible path at that point of time. Next, coming to the autopilot, you may find it interesting that according to a report of New York Times, nowadays pilots are, most of the time, the planes are running in autopilot mode. And only during takeoff and landing time, the pilots are actually in charge of the plane. But apart from those things, they are just, you know, having the plane in autopilot mode. So it was reported in that article that around only 7 minutes, the pilots are taking the charge. Rest of the time, autopilot mode is on. So there also, AI technology is being harnessed to, I don't know how do they use, but it's true that they use AI technology to, you know, ensure the smooth operation or, you know, the smooth fly actually. Now coming to the social networking, all of us use Facebook, Instagram, or at least have used at some point of time. So how do you think that this face tagging happens? whenever we put some photo, Facebook try to detect the, you know, that person, and it tried to show. It also tried to detect the face, in fact. So there are neural networks running behind all those, you know, behind the scenes actually, and that's why they're able to give you the precise, you know, the face tagging and all these things. Instagram, they also use sentiment analysis. They also use the emojis which we put in our chats to detect the sentiment. So all of us know that sentiment analysis is also a very, you know, interesting topic these days. Twitter sentiment analysis and all these things. So these are some of the applications where machine learning has found its immense application. And machine learning definitely has solved some of the, you know, huge problems. So that's why it has found its way. Now healthcare, medical sector, of course, it needs utmost attention. We all know this thing. So like IBM's Watson, in case of IBM Watson, they have been found that they are able to diagnose some of the diseases more accurate than the doctors. So if you Google about IBM Watson, you may find it more about it. Similarly, in case of finance sector, now like Godis are also mentioned about these things, that in case of banking, they are also using these techniques to check whether this person might be a defaulter or not. So whether a loan should be sanctioned to this person or not. So similarly, we take on, you know, we apply machine learning at several places to solve some of the problems. And since machine learning has proved, you know, very useful at several occasions, so that's why it is getting, you know, immense applications every day. So these are, and now this is the relation between these three things which we have been discussing, like AI, ML, and then DL. So in case of ML and DL, like you can see that one is a subset of another, definitely. So coming to ML and DL, so in case of DL mainly, it has been said, or at least if you have seen the lectures of Coursera founder Dr. Andrew Ng, you will find that they claim that deep learning proves very useful, or at least it surpasses machine learning when you have a very large amount of data. Because for large amount of data, machine learning becomes saturated, but deep learning keeps on, you know, performing better and better with as the data is increasing. So that's why nowadays, since we are having autonomous vehicles, we are having wearable devices, we are having n number of applications, or at least n number of devices which we are using on daily basis. So that's why deep learning comes into picture, because we have a large amount of data, and how to make sense out of that data, how to use that data to serve the customer in a better way. So these things definitely can be solved by using deep learning. Apart from this, there is also one very interesting area called consumer internet. So by consumer internet, suppose you are using, you know, Instagram, or you are using, you know, Facebook. So the your home feed, the things which appear, you know, on your home page, like someone shared something or anything, face, photo, video, or anything. So how do you think that when some video becomes viral, how do that video comes in your feed in the very first way? And viral, you know, viral video keeps on changing. Like today, this video is viral, tomorrow there will be some another video viral. So how do the algorithm ensures that the viral videos are kept on the top? So every 6 hours or every 12 hours, an algorithm runs, and they find all the, you know, viral things from the internet, and then they try to show that feed to the customer. So you see how these things are becoming important day by day. And while, you know, you're customizing or giving you the viral videos or viral content, they are somehow using the concept of deep learning, because there is vast amount of data. And that's why they can use neural networks to solve the problem, or at least to serve the customer in a better way. Because if a viral video, if it is viral today, and if I get to see today, then I will find it better. But if I get to see it after, you know, 3 or 4 days, I will definitely lose interest, because by that time something other would have become viral. So that's why time also is a very important thing over there. So these things are somehow, we are really surrounded by, you know, vast applications of machine learning. And I must say that it's really, it is solving some problems, and in some cases it has definitely surpassed human intelligence. And so it is finding its use every day. Now, a basic thing is, like, whenever we are starting machine learning, so somehow we feel that, okay, just take a data from internet, find out some code, and then, you know, run some models, and we are happy that we got 90% accuracy. But we never think, like, what does 90% accuracy even mean? Whether that accuracy is sufficient enough, or whether that accuracy is not sufficient. So, for example, you know, in case of healthcare, suppose I am building a model which will be detecting the cancer, or benign, or those who are from bio, they will understand better that in cancer cells we have benign and malign cells. So if we are having a model which will detect whether it is a benign or malign cell, so in that case, you know, even if we miss on detecting one single case, then the model has not done its job, because we cannot say that that person was having cancer, but we said that he was not having cancer. So that way the model is not doing its job properly. So the meaning of accuracy changes at every, you know, application. Now coming to this thing, how to take on an ML problem. So, you know, problem definition is very important. We need to know whether this problem is a good problem for machine learning or not. Because everything, you know, a lot of things definitely can be done using machine learning, but there are things which cannot be done by using machine learning, or at least should not be done by using machine learning. There might be some other ways to solve that problem, but you need to know, like, whether this problem can be solved using machine learning, or at least this problem, or you know, by using ML, I can accelerate something, I can change something. Though that thing should be there, then. Because in real life, we find some problem, then you think on solving it. Then we don't have the data. So we have to look for the data first. So we gather data. Now, many a time people fail in this step only, because we realize that there is no way to find the data. Mainly in case of medical sectors, it's very difficult to find data for medical diagnosis, because those data are, you know, it's very difficult to find those data. Similarly, in case of other sectors as well, like if you don't get data, then we cannot do anything about it. But now if we get data, then we have to prepare it. By preparing, we mean that we have to, you know, first take it in some very good format, because the real life data are not clean. So there are some missing values, some outliers, lots of things are there. So we have to prepare that data. And preparing also involves, you know, EDA. EDA means exploratory data analysis, where you try to find the important features in that data, which can be used to build a model. So those things, I mean, these 5 or 6 points, whatever I have mentioned here, those things are very closely, you know, packed. We cannot see it separate. They are very closely packed, and these points mean a lot. Means every step involves very, you know, vast amount of work. And you might have heard about this cliche that many a time data scientists are spending a lot of time on preparing data only, because once the data is clean, then they are good to go. But it does not happen quite often. The data in real life is very messy. It has a lot of issues. If you get the data in a very proper format, then it's like, you know, it's like heaven. So now after getting the data, then we train the model, we evaluate it. And then of course, evaluation means that we try to ensure that the performance which we are getting is up to the mark. Like in case of, like we talked about medical diagnosis, even if we are missing one point, so that is not a good scenario. But in case of, suppose, some simple classification, for example, spam classification, even that is a good problem. But the point is, like, suppose we are building a model which is saying apple and apple. So in that case, if you miss out one data point, then that's not a big deal. But when it comes to, you know, security, your health, life and death, then we cannot miss out on anything. We have to be very, very sure. So these things are there. We tune the parameters to make the model work. So that's why I believe that when you are, you know, working on some ML problem, means when you are trying to take on some new problem, then you need to think on these points first. Like whether this problem needs to be solved using machine learning or not, whether there can be some other way. Many times we say that the problems for which we are already having a very good mathematical formula, for that we don't need to, you know, apply machine learning. For example, when will the next solar eclipse occur? That does not need to be solved using machine learning, because we already have a very good calculation by which we can predict when will that eclipse occur. Similarly, in other case as well. So we need to take these things into consideration. Now coming to types of machine learning. So these four are the broad, broad classifications, but obviously reinforcement learning, this is mainly used in, I guess, autonomous vehicles and all these things. We will be covering the first two, supervised and unsupervised. And I think most of the real life issues, I guess, at least for machine learning, in case of deep learning, there are some other issues as well, some other points which we need to be covered. But in case of machine learning, at least we can, we are good to go with only these two. So we know this definition pretty much. Sir has also covered this thing, like in case of supervised, we have some label on the data. So we can simply, you know, that label is basically used to supervise the model. Means we can tell the model that you are doing wrong, you are doing right. So that's why its name is supervised, because there is some supervisor, and the label is a supervisor. That is basically saying, like, you are doing good, the model is working right or wrong. So these are two main types, classification and regression, obviously. And we know classification means finding out some discrete, like suppose, saying an apple, orange and orange. But suppose you are building a model which will predict the price of houses, that will become continuous value. So that becomes a regression problem. So these two are main, types of supervised learning. Now, sir has also mentioned, we will cover this very example, in case of iris flower, we are having, these three species primarily, versicolor, setosa, and virginica. Now, if we can see that there, this is sepal and this is petal actually. So there is some dimension difference among these three species. So one can easily argue, or at least by doing some analysis, one can conclude that we can use the dimensions of these, sepal and petal to build a model, which can predict the species of a new iris flower. So here we can have a data set something like this, sepal length, sepal width. So these four can be used as features, and this is the label. So now this is, of course, an inbuilt data set in RStudio. So we can simply, we have a label, so we can use it when we build a model, then we can use it as a label or a supervisor, in fact. Now, the questions is, in fact, for any machine learning problem, we need to ask these two questions. Can we build a model that can learn from the data whose labels we already have? For example, in case of iris, we already have the label. So we can think, so for this, we need to run some kind of analysis. And I will, present two terms here. Those who are looking for data scientist profiles or data analyst, you will get to know about these things better once you join some job. So there are two different things. One is exploratory data analysis, and then another is explanatory data analysis, exploratory and explanatory. Exploratory means the data scientist or the person doing the, he or she is doing just a job of finding out whether there are some important features which can be, used to build a model. And explanatory means that we are presenting that these features, those things to a client or, to the third party. So while exploratory, we are doing a lot of things because at that time we are trying. But once we finalize some values, like these features are really important, then we present those things to our client. So that there we have to be very, very specific, or we have to also ensure that the client gets the idea. So these are some of the important things which we need to answer while building any model. So this is one of the example. Now we will be using support vector machine for our model, which I will show in the demo right now. So support vector machine we will be definitely using, and there are a lot of models like decision trees there, random forest is there, bagging boosting concept is there. So SVM I will be presenting, because we cannot present all the things due to the paucity of time, but definitely I will just show one example or one model by which we will be predicting the iris, data set. And then we will also see how to evaluate the performance, that you will see in a while. So coming back to RStudio, so here we have a classification model, and I am assuming that it is working directly. Yeah, so if you have a look at normal iris data set, so you'll realize that they are having three levels, like setosa, and then versicolor and virginica. But for the sake of convenience, I am using a data set which is having only two levels, setosa and versicolor, that we'll see here. So for example, if I run this particular chunk, so see here I am having only two levels, setosa and versicolor. So I will explain why I am having these two, because in case of confusion matrix, if you are drawing a 3x3 matrix, that will be a bit complex. So I am just having 2x2 matrix for the sake of confusion matrix. So here, if we see, I have this library used for confusion matrix, this is used for support vector, and all these things you know. Now, see, I am first trying to see whether there is, if I draw these two things, sepal length and sepal width, as x and y axis, and I am using ggplot definitely here. So I will see whether these two are important parameters to judge the species. So as we can see, in this case, see, this red one is the setosa and this other one is the versicolor. Now we see that depending on these two, sepal length and sepal width, we see that there is some boundary beyond. On one side of that boundary, we have one species, another side, we have another species. So definitely we can draw a line over here and then when we have a new data point, we will check whether that point lies here and here, and then we will make the prediction. But you know, this data set is really very, very clean and good to look at. But in real life, you will not find, you know, this much separable, because in case of SVM, we have kernels, the concept of kernels, like linear, radial, all these things are there. So here we can see that we can simply draw a line to separate these two points, these two, you know, species. But suppose we have something like, Gudi sir has shown a very good diagram, that we have something like, you know, one thing going inside some circle type shape. Then we cannot draw a line. Then a line won't do the job. Then we might have to do some kind of curve, something like a circle or something, or an arc maybe. So that thing comes under kernel of SVM. You can read about kernels in SVM, and then you will realize that how kernels are very good to solve that the data which are not linearly separable. Here it's quite easy that we can simply draw a line. And of course, once you are used to building some complex models, you will face those examples very soon. So here I realize that, okay, I can draw a line in between these two. So by drawing a line means SVM. SVM is a very good tool to, you know, where we find the hyperplane, and that hyperplane is used to distinguish between the two species. You can read about SVM, that stands for support vector machine. And I guess I can show you a diagram maybe. I guess this diagram should give an idea. So see these things, like, you know, I will be just be drawing a line, but the line will be, because here we can have multiple lines which will separate the data, but we have to find the line with maximum margin hyperplane. Now these are some terms which you are used to solve SVM, actually, which are used to represent SVM in fact. So see, we should have maximum margin. So you can read about maximum margin hyperplane later, and of course we will be leaving the slides as well. So now see, here the data is not linearly separable, so we are shifting the data, we are adding another dimension. So this is solved by using kerneling. You can read about it, kerneling and all these things. So yeah, so I will just I have also plotted these things like petal length and petal width. So see, here we are having a better distinction. So see, it's having a very good distinction that, okay, this area is for setosa and this is for versicolor. But the point is that if it is so clear, then we don't need to build any model for that matter. But I guess here the model might help. Okay, so yeah, so similarly, we can keep on plotting across various axes or various features. Like I have done sepal length, petal length. Then I have also drawn the box plot, in fact. So see, in case of box plot, if I draw on the basis of sepal length, so you know that box plot is something which has five values, like median values, then 25%, 75%, and then the maximum and outlier concept. So this is the draw of, you know, sepal length only. But if I draw petal length, then there is very clear cut distinction. Like the versicolor range is from this only, but the setosa is this only. So we are having a very good distinction, but again we are using sepal length primarily. So now as I have seen that in this data set we have four features, like sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width. Now if I go on drawing these four things in a 2D plane, I won't be able to draw. And SVM, and then I won't be able to show you the hyperplane in a better way. So what I will do is I will take only two features out of this data set, and I will show you how the SVM looks like. So I will select sepal length, sepal width, and the species. I will drop these two. Of course, in real life, we try to take as many columns as possible, until and unless they are not useful. We take because the columns indicate the importance, or at least the important details about that species. But here, just for the sake of convenience and the plot, I will be just drawing these two dimensions only. And I am now here. I am creating a data set, these two lines. And this is subset function you have seen somewhere in the tutorial as well. And I am just taking sepal length and species. So if I run it, I am just getting these three things. And now I will build my model on this data set. Now I am going on. Okay, so now again, you might be knowing about this thing, train and test concept. So in case of machine learning, when we are building machine learning models, so whatever data we have, we split it into 80-20%. Like 80% for training and 20% for testing. Because while testing, we try to check that whether our model is doing good or unseen data or not. So test data, we completely keep aside. Nowadays, people also have test, train, and validation data. So you will also find this logic over internet. So here we are only using train and test. So I'm just splitting train and test concept. Okay, let me run this chunk. So I have this, now I have train and test split. Now I will build a SVM model, and I'm using a linear kernel. Then you plot a summary, and then I will plot the SVM model. So see, this is being plotted on the train data set, actually on the train set. So this cross actually support vectors, because these are used to find the best or maximum margin hyperplane. So in this case, it is not making any mistake. All the points are correctly classified. There is not an issue. So because the data was pretty, you know, linearly separable, so it did its job. Now, if I make the kernel as radial, so you will see that the shape should change a bit. Yeah, so see, the shape changes a bit, because now it is trying to fit a, you know, arc type shape or a non-linear shape in front. But here we do not require non-linear, because data was linearly separable, in fact. Now what I will do is I will check how did the model do, actually, even though it seems that it did a very good job. But the point is that I will now test the model on test data set. So here I will predict the test data set samples now, and I will draw the confusion matrix. So see, this is the confusion matrix. This is the confusion matrix. And here, as we see, so I will try to maximize it. I will also highlight it. So in this area, at least. So you might have seen confusion matrix, that it is a 2x2 matrix if we are having two classes. Now, that's why I kept two classes only, Setosa and Varsikar. If I kept three classes, then I will have to draw 3x3 matrix. So that will be might a bit, you know, complex to understand. Now the point is that we are having simple, so see, this is reference means the actual true level. Now Setosa, Varsikala, Setosa, and this is prediction. So Setosa and Setosa means the species, which was Setosa, what was Setosa. So we are having 10, so these two things will say the accuracy, like 19/20. So see, we have a question 95%. So one instance is wrongly classified, like this is Setosa, but it is predicted Versicolor. I will show the confusion matrix slide so that it will be better. Yeah, so in case of like supervised learning, we have to draw some kind of, you know, performance evaluation. So as we see here, that classification, in case of classification, we have accuracy, precision, recall. I will explain the meaning of these two in the next slide. Accuracy, we know, like how many wrong and like how many correct classifications upon total number of data points. Simple, like here we did. We simply had 20 points and 19 correct upon 20, 95%, simple. But accuracy is not the, it should not be the only parameter, because sometimes, I will explain it in the next slide. Then in case of regression, we have these things like mean absolute error, root mean square error, these things we are having. So we can use these things to evaluate the performance. Now coming to confusion matrix. So here we see true positive, true negative, these things you have definitely come across. I will focus on precision and recall, because these things are less hard terms, actually. So precision, you know, in case of precision, we are simply trying to evaluate the total positive. So see, TP upon TP upon FP means the total predicted positive across all positive predicted. So TP upon this particular row. Recall is this particular row. So in case of now, there is another thing like sensitivity, specificity, F1 score is basically, I guess, harmonic mean of these two. So F1 score, people always say that it's a better idea to have F1 score. So see, now in case of precision, suppose we are building a email spam detection in which, you know, spam is one and non-spam is zero, something like that. So in that case, we can go for precision. But in case of, you know, some medical diagnosis, we can go for recall. So it depends upon which thing is important for us, positive or negative. Like in case of medical, suppose cancer diagnosis, if a person is having cancer and we take it as positive, means positive class, in fact, positive class. And now by mistake, we say that person was not having cancer, means we say that negative. Now we made a false negative. So false negative is something which we cannot afford over here, because you know, cancer, it's about life and death. So we cannot, afford giving misjudgment over here. So depending upon the use cases, we have several techniques to solve. So that's why in case of accuracy or mainly in case of imbalanced data set, like in case of medical diagnosis only, suppose we have a data set having 100 rows and out of 100 rows, we have 90 non-cancer, 10 cancer only. And our model predicted all the non-cancers pretty well. In fact, if it says non-cancer for all the data points, even then it will show 90% accuracy because 90 cancer points, non-cancer, 10 cancer points. But it said it was wrong for all the cancer points. So that way did not serve its purpose. We cannot rely on accuracy only. There we have to look on these things. So that's why, next time when you build some model, you also need to check on these things, like how the model is doing on these parameters. Mainly in case of class imbalance, we have to check these things or depending upon the application as well. So I guess we are done with more or less, supervised learning. And so we can take a few questions if there are, and then we can move to unsupervised learning. Any questions we have? Okay, so if we are not having any question.
Sudhakar, I can proceed.
Okay, sure, sir. Yeah, so now we will talk about unsupervised learning definitely. So yeah, so this is another thing where we are not having label to the data, in fact. So I will use the same data set, Iris data set, but this time we will not be using the label, in fact, for training the model. You know, some of the important applications are like customer segmentation. So, you know, whenever we do some online shopping, the e-commerce websites, they try to put us into some clusters. And they try to, find the pattern, like this particular person has this, hobby, or he or she buys these things quite often. So let us keep him or her in this particular cluster. So next time they will be, when we visit the website, they will be putting us in that cluster and they will try to show us those things only. So customer segmentation and other, these things are very, very important when it comes to, unsupervised learning. And like, if you are having a lot of things to segregate, then also we can do unsupervised learning. So now, so now take us this data set. Suppose now we are not having any label of this. Now how will we arrange? How can we say that, how many clusters we can create out of this Iris data set? So in this case, the thing become important because now it depends on us how to find the optimal number of clusters. Yes. So like Ravindra sir also mentioned that it is our responsibility or it is upon us to find the optimal number of clusters. But there are certain methods as well, like elbow plot and all these things. Elbow plot, you can Google it later, like elbow method, where it shows, it draws basically an elbow kind of plot and it shows like the optimal number of clusters actually. So in this case, since we know that these data points are mainly about three species, so we will go with three clusters. That is a very good thing. But normally we will not be having the label. So there we have to use some elbow plot and another kind of tools to find the optimal number of clusters. So clustering, I think Ravin sir had already covered. So now KMS cluster, I will just show this elbow plot once, how it looks like. So see, this is the elbow plot actually. You can refer to this website later. So here we see that after number of four clusters, we are getting the same, within cluster sum of squares. So that way, even if we keep 14, we will not be getting a better result. So I think four or five should be the optimal number of clusters. So this way we actually find the optimal number of clusters. And we call actually within cluster sum of squares. So and then we plot this thing. Okay. So this thing we can check, and now I will draw the clustering in R. So I will go on clustering model. So again, we are using the Iris data set, but this time we are having the normal Iris data set, and I will run this particular chunk. So see, we are having three levels, four features, all these things are good. Now what I will do is I will also see the structure. So this is just a command, like, different structures are there. Now I am drawing a scatter plot of all the species using these two dimensions, these two features at least. So see, okay, just a second. Yeah, so see. So here, if we see, we are having, three species, of course. So we can have one cluster over here, but these two are intermixed actually. if we rely on sepal length and sepal widths. So these two are a bit mixed. Now definitely if we build on three clusters, then of course there will be some, you know, wrong or some misclassification between these two clusters. So again, that will happen in real life as well, because we are trying to cluster. So this will do good, but here there will be some, you know, intermixing. But in case of petal length, see, this is a very good visualization, because of course it because of features only. So here we are having very good three clusters out of this visualization, very good three clusters. But of course in real life you might not find, you know, very clear distinction. There you will have to take some call, you know, based on your knowledge and your judgment. And because in real life this will not be the case quite often, there you will find some, in fact a lot of intermixing will happen over there. So then there are several methods to find optimal number of, like Elbow method and all these things. But here if you rely on building a model of this particular thing, so see, so now what I will do is I will draw a k-means clustering on this, and I will give the number of clusters to be 3, and I am taking data from 1 to 4. Okay, 1 to 4 means column, it's column actually. So 1 to 4 means this 1 to 4, 1 2 3 4, in our indexing starts from 1 not 0. So, and because since we are trying to build a, you know, unsupervised model, so we will drop this species. We will simply have 1 2 3 4. So that's why we are having data frame, then column indexing 1 to 4 only, and then we are building the model. So if I go on this iris cluster, so say this is the cluster. Now what I will do is I will plot the scatter plot, but this time I will color the, you know, data points by the cluster which we have found actually. By the cluster, because here in this section we got some clusters. If you see, you got some clusters. Now I will use this cluster value to paint the color of that particular. So see, we are getting more or less the same result. If we go on back, so see this particular image. So ideally this is one cluster, so we are expecting one color for this and the two for this one. Here again, see, so this is somewhat, of course it is wrongly classifying one or two points, like I guess this one and this one, but it is doing a decent job, at least I can say. So this way, now there are several ways in R you will find a number of libraries to plot the clusters, but this is the minimal which I could come across, which I could come up. So I did these things to plot. So I guess these things we supposed to cover, or we plan to cover in this time, like supervised learning or supervised learning, and how to think about it, how to evaluate the performance in case of classification we saw, precision, recall, all these things we saw. And because accuracy everyone knows, and it's a very common technique to find it, but precision recall also, because in real life data is imbalanced, several issues are there. So there we have to rely on, we cannot rely only on accuracy. So these are the things which you have come across, and I guess you might have got some idea about these two learning methods. So yeah, I guess this was what I was supposed to cover. So we can take on some question depending on the time which we have available.
Yeah, we can take just few questions actually.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
If our data is mixed too much, like if there is too much intermixing, so what we have to do then? Do we have to find another feature of data which is which distincts the data set, different datas, or is there some method where we can actually differentiate even if there is intermixing?
So you're talking about clustering or what, classification?
Classification, sir.
Classification. So see, now there are several techniques, like in case of SVM, if data is separable at least linearly or by some technique, then SVM is a very good tool. Or we also have decision tree, but decision tree, they are able to handle non-linearity in data. So you can also go for decision trees, then the random forest, these things we can try. But I guess if you are having a lot of intermixing, then you will have to, I think decision tree should be the good option. As far as I have seen, I might not be that correct, but I guess decision tree should be the, better option at least.
Okay.
Yeah, I may add one more point to this. See, if you have a lot of mixing thing, then the thing is that you're supposed to make a lot of mistake actually. So that problem is more difficult. So you will be having a lot of misclassification, because it's having this thing. And another thing what people try is that it maybe look at some transformation, and in that transformed space it could be having some separability. So for classification, separability is the main thing. Okay.
Yeah. And sir, one more question. Sir, is there some measure of mix, like intermixing of the data? Like suppose that I am automating something and I am getting different data. So every time I won't be able to look at the data, and the system has to process the data itself. So like, are there some quantify, like it can quantify the mixing of the data so that I know that now I have to use this method and now this method?
Yeah, I mean, I think it is possible. There is, I don't know any such criterion, but what one can look at the density estimates. And if the density is having a lot of overlap, then you know that there will be a lot of mixing thing. So okay. One can try this thing. But as such, that how much mixing is there, that you can guess actually from looking at the range and looking at the values, what it takes. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Smita ma'am, can you take over?
So, any other question? Yeah, certificate and certificate you will get in some days. Actually, we will create it, and you will have to log in on the NMICT website with your register email ID, and you can download the certificate there. But you will get an email saying that the certificate is available on our website portal. Professor Radhi, can you answer this question? They are asking that are there any open book source to learn machine learning subject?
Yeah, I think nowadays, if you search on the Google, you will find many things. But if you want to do some statistical learning, actually, I mentioned this book earlier also, this Introduction to Statistical Learning with Application in R by James Witten, Hasty, and Teep Sirani. That is quite reasonable book actually, and it doesn't have much theory. It just tells you the processes, that tells you the methods actually. So yeah, you can look at that book. If you want, you can look at several even this Hasty, Teep Sirani have some more books on this, but that is more related to that they will explain you the procedure also. Okay. So you can look at this book, or you can search from the online thing. And these books are available online freely, actually. You don't have to purchase, actually. Yeah. You don't have to purchase. It's freely available online. Yeah, so I think it was a very good thing. You'd have this, the two methods what has been told to you, at least you could learn that this SVM, how does the SVM works, and how does this K-means cluster is there. And at least in R, you can implement it. You can implement it easily. And I hope these codes will be made available to you. Smita, is it like that? We will be making these codes available to the candidates?
Yes, sir. We have already shared that with them. But I think classification clustering, I will check it whether I have shared it or not.
Yeah.
But we are going to share it by evening.
Yeah, so you will be having these codes also. So suppose if you get a new series, new problem you want to implement, you can implement using these code only. But the thing is that, see, the different features, different this thing is there. See, this iris data has this nice thing also that you, with some variable, you can find the total separability. Okay, so this is a very somewhat looks like a very trivial problem. Typically it is not like that. So in most of the examples, real life examples, you'll have a lot of mixing. And then it is more interesting that which method works best, actually. See, that's why there are plenty of methods. Okay. SVM was the one such, there is nearest neighbor, what he was saying, decision tree, random forest. So many classification algorithms are there. So one can use, and these are produced because the real life problems really needed different mechanisms to get the partition action, where these assumptions may not hold. So you need to look for something else where you can have a better classification. Okay. Yeah. So I think for introduction to the machine learning classification and clustering, this was a very good job. Sudhakar, thank you very much. So if there is any other question, yeah, then I can. And what about the regression and other stuff? If you have any question, yeah, you need to ask, you can ask.
We could complete that, sir. We could complete it in the afternoon.
Okay. Okay. Very good. Because we had some internet issues.
Correct.
Yeah. So if you have some questions related to the association or regression thing, you can ask now. So you have also seen that at least in the second introduction part, that regression is also like a machine learning tool. But this is a very classical statistical analysis. Similarly, this classification and clustering, they are actually it's not a new thing. It's a very old thing. People were knowing this thing and doing from the very old days, but then computing facility was not there. So with the advent of fast computers, we can have many more algorithms to solve these problems numerically. So earlier days, suppose you had that 100 data points and you had to compute 100, choose too many distances, it may take you even a day, right? A complete day is lost only to compute that. So, and then iterations will take even much more time. So people were not doing this thing in old days, but the ideas were known actually. Yeah. I hope that you have understood something about R and it will be useful to you. And
can we move on to next session now?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.